Without choosing a side or another, just choose the whole.
How does culture shape religion? Religion shape culture. I was born in a Hindu family and was given a Christian upbringing. And then in my adult life, I chose to go back to my roots and identify myself as a Hindu. But it's a journey through cultures, I can say. The Hindu culture, and then complete abandonment of Hindu culture and embracing the Christian thinking and Christian culture. When I say Christian, it's more Western culture, even if I was raised in India. And then complete abandonment of Christian culture and then embracing my roots. And when I started embracing my roots, I tried to understand, I tried to dig deeper into my own culture, my own customs, belief systems, practices, but in a better informed state of mind. So when I went back to my roots, it was more with a scientific approach. There was the culture, yes, but this time around it was with approach that would reconcile the customs and the practices, including the worship of whatever deities and those things, with an element of reconcile that practice with common sense, I should say. So the aspect of Hinduism shaping my culture or my practices, my thinking, rested largely on what I consumed as part of what is out there about Hinduism, the way of Hindu life and all of that that I was consuming as a Hindu. So the truth seeking continues. I call myself a sadhak, and the thought, the religious thought, evolves as does the culture that I embrace. So it's an ongoing thing. It will continue and they will evolve. So to answer the question how religion, how culture shapes religion, it has a huge impact on how you practice your religion, or how you don't practice any religion at all. Culture definitely has a lot of impact on the religious aspect.
Before sharing my thoughts on how religion affects us individually and group, I want all of you to ponder on this thought. All the existing prominent, because there can be many others, existing big prominent religions of the world, have you ever thought that they all are Asian in origin? Think about it. Sometimes I just say that in my conversations and some people say, what? All are Asian in origin? Well, actually think about it. All the prominent ones are actually Asian in origin. But that's not my point. The next point we say is how the religion affects us. It's important to understand how even the very formation of religion is affected. For example, just for simplicity, and this is a very simplistic analysis, take say Abrahamic religions. So think of Judaism, Christianity, and say Islam. Okay, in terms of their origin, the place of origin, and if you look at the Native American traditions, and if you go back to genetics, then you will find even they came from Asia, you know, in a different way, but that's just a point of humor. But if you look at the Abrahamic religions, the landscape, I don't mean so much the culture, because culture may come afterwards or it may exist, but in formulation of the religion, the landscape matters. So if it's like a flat desert like land where not much changes, in terms of the evolution of philosophy, it may develop a certain type of philosophy. So if I have to broadly categorize, say, Judaistic religion versus, say, take Hinduism, just for an example, or even the some offshoots of Hinduism like Buddhism and Jainism. What you say is one difference, and I'll take one. Is there a reincarnation? Do we reincarnate versus we don't reincarnate? So this is a very simplistic analysis, but maybe you're just seeing a flat desert, everything happens like this, not much change of season, and you think, you know what? Nothing changes, except the one thing that changes is some people are born and they are dead. Okay? On the other hand, if you look at, say, tropical landscape, you see not just you, but everything, you know, it's going through a certain seasons and it has that repeatability. So something that we thought was lost has come again. And then the last step is, say, depending on whichever you take it, whether the reincarnation exists or not, and my point is not to push you in any one direction, but once you make that mind, actually that religious thought or a cultural thought defines how you behave. And just a simple example I'll take is from a stock market. The actual, your money may be in stock market, you have no intention of taking it out or anything, but if your stock is doing very well, you just take the money in your bank and go shopping. On the other hand, if the stock had just fallen recently, has taken 30% dive or something like this, you may have still the same money in your bank account, but you say, you know what, I will skip shopping this weekend. Okay? In that sense, I think whether you accept reincarnation or not, it's in some sense changes your behavior. This I just gave as a one example, and I think that applies for many other tenets of individual religions.
Now, I'll come to more controversial. I'm trying to create controversy and nobody is taking it. I want people to throw these flower vases at each other and say, I hate you. Nothing is happening yet. So, when you look at the study of the history of the history, culture, history of culture, now we see all over the world the failed economies and successful economies. The failed economies, you'll see a certain pattern, and all of you are smart and would have even say explicitly. And the successful economies, you see a pattern. And that pattern is visible to a blind eye also. So visible. So my question to you, Adriana, is that why countries which focus on religion fail?
Conquering comes through beliefs and money and all those truths that we were talking about before, and all about language and the interpretation of how people see the world. So I can recall, like for example, Marcus Aurelius, like back in the day, if you read some of the self, you know, help books now, they have bases back then. Why? That was working, but the fact that he chose a son to follow instead of being chosen by in Rome, everything is an impact of power and money, right? Everything. So whatever we see around, it's the same thing. I am an immigrant here in this country, and I moved here with my three sons. They were back in the day, 7, 9, and 11. But I had to quiet my grief, because I was, you know, fortunate enough to not be an immigrant of not having anything and have to start from scratch. That doesn't mean I didn't let go of what of my origins were. What I'm saying about this is that all about money and power override culture at some point, and we have to be brave enough to step on it and see it.
Isn't that the purpose of religion, to take away the greed and pride and power? Okay, Larry.
No, I'll get back to it, you know, the fact that geography will continue to fade away as technology continues to march on. I mean, people who watch the same media, whether TV shows, internet content, whatever, have more in common with each other than they necessarily have in common with their neighbor. And it's gonna get more and more. I'm doing an award show in February. And let me just tell you some of the technology I'm using. So coming out of Las Vegas, the show is gonna be, the host of, in English, but I'm putting it out on a Zoom feed on steroids. We have 570,000 Zoom feeds simultaneously. So when you sign up for it and you watch the show, I know where you came in from. But I'm using artificial intelligence. When my host speaks English, in France the host speaks French, in Spain the host speaks Spain Spanish, in Mexico they speak Mexican Spanish, to the point where I'm using AI to manipulate the facial muscles. So when you watch the show, the host is speaking that language. It doesn't look dubbed or whatever. But think of the implications of that when people like me, who are going to continue to create global media, because again, I think we have much more in common than we do have differences.
Can you repeat the question? I couldn't completely hear that.
I forgot the question.
Originally, you were talking about freedom of economies.
No, I remember. Now I remember. Okay. So why do the countries which follow focus on religion fail? If religion was important and all those things are important, she said that it's all about the power and greed, and religion is supposed to take it away. So in summary, my question was, why countries which focus on religion fail?
Okay. I must have something in my ear. It's very hard for me. I thought originally you said about freedom of economies and how that affects successful economy versus non-successful.
Because of my beautiful pronunciation, did you hear me twice?
Well, I think we are all answering different questions, but I'll answer a new question perhaps. Originally I thought the question was, are free economies more able to be successful than more religion-tied economies?
Correct.
You didn't ask.
Paraphrased very well. Yes.
Is that okay?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, I'll make up my own story.
Perfect.
Then.
Yes.
All right.
Now you have
good.
Your story.
Good. When we are, as a human race, free to create, there's no limits. There's no limits. There is nothing impossible, and there's no limits. When people impart their ceilings on us and try to change our self-image, our confidence, through laws and rules that we don't even know about, or I heard the word manipulation. A lot of manipulation going on at the moment. Unimaginable, actually. And to Larry's point, it's probably around the globe. And I think, without a doubt, the economies that are the most free will thrive versus the other way. And I believe in the human race that, even though there's many reasons, as you had mentioned, money and power to control us, manipulate us, eventually the human spirit will always win. As long as we tell the truth, tell our truth, speak our truth, and talk, be there, you know, make your opinion, make your voice, everyone's voice is so important, and there's really no limits in a free society to be who you want to be and to create globally.
Yeah, I want you to repeat the question. Maybe you should speak without the mic because it's echoing. Just so I hear.
So, why do countries which focus... Actually, Eric did it better than me.
Why do countries focus on culture?
No.
Religion.
Why do countries that focus on religion fail?
Religious faith.
No. Why do countries which focus on religions fail?
Okay. Rigidity, dogma, that would be the first answer, a one-word answer. So countries that focus on religion...
But I'll add one more point. They make the best Hollywood scripts.
So, I come from a country that has multiple religions are practiced, multiple religions have taken birth on that soil, but they all existed peacefully, I say existed peacefully, until practitioners of few religions actually took their religion very seriously and that's took the dogma of their religion very seriously. So countries that completely focus on religion give more importance to the dogma of the religion than the citizens of that country. So any place where the human spirit is killed, those countries are bound to fail. So like Eric said, the human spirit must prevail by all means. When that spirit is crushed, there's something called karma. So whoever is doing that will definitely fail in their in whatever they are doing. So let's say if a particular government of that country, which focuses on religion and religious dogma, is the perpetrator, which is killing of human spirit, free voice, freedom of speech, so karma will eventually catch up with those governments, and of course they'll fail. So that's my understanding of how karma works and how the perpetrator eventually gets caught by his or her or their own karma.
All right. I was going to say, if Aditya was going to ask me any question, I was going to say, no matter what question he asks, my answer is already decided. Just relate, I think that question possibly is answered, or the multiple questions. But what I would like to share related to this is this. Related to a certain country following a certain religion, or certain area following a certain emphasis on the religion. When you insist on calcifying or insisting something should be followed of a specific religion, usually you tend to focus on the differences, because that's why you want to follow this and it must be followed. On the other hand, if you try to, as I said, read voraciously or travel widely, when you try to understand different religions just for enriching your understanding, yes, you may recognize the differences, but your emphasis is in finding the common factor. One of the great American, how many of you know, heard, or read works of Joseph Campbell? Okay, good number of you. I would say my experience, like coming from India, I left India when I was 20 years old to do my master's in Canada. And it so happened that one time I was cooking, I was working there, and on the TV, on the PBS, The Power of Myth, which is a famous program with Joseph Campbell, that was running on. But at that time, I did not know who Joseph Campbell was. And even my back was to the TV and I was cooking. But whatever he said, just happened to say, I just had a feeling, and this is my subjective experience then, that whoever this person is definitely a self-realized person or someone very close to it. And then I got interested into it, I started reading, I have read every single of his book multiple times and so on. What is interesting I will share is, when I left India, and me as a practicing Hindu, I thought, even at 20, that's not too young, that I understood Hinduism. And yes, to a great extent I had, but it was, I will say, singularly Joseph Campbell and his writing, and not just writings on Hinduism, but writings on all the religions, all the mythologies of the world, that actually made me understand, say, what Hinduism is, but also what is the common factors, or what is the gist of all the different religions. Thank you.
Great. After listening to everyone, I am more confused, okay? And I'm being honest. So I'll ask you guys to clarify, ask me questions to any one of them, any of the panelists. So you can come forward if you have any questions. And, okay.
Okay, I'm going to give my wife here. So I'm that post-lunch relief to wake the audience up as well as some of the panelists up. A good reference on Joseph Campbell, I think that was Bill Moyers, The Power of Myth, that you were thinking of. and the hero's journey that you mentioned. It's very apt to the panel itself. Religion and culture, right? Culture, first some comments and then I'll ask you whether you agree with me or not. From what I've heard so far from the panelists, culture is something organic over a longitudinal accumulation of truths that a certain body of people believe in. It's grounds up, it's bottoms up. That's culture. So culture is always local. The definition of culture is defined by the people for the people. Whereas the concept of religion, which is not a Sanatana Dharma concept, religion is not a way of life. Religion is almost like man's way of fighting war to win minds. So it's top down. This is the way. It's more inorganic from top down, whereas culture is bottoms up. It's just a statement. Agree, disagree. I'd like to hear your opinion.
That's a great way of looking at it. I'd like to say that it's not always organic, i.e. from planet Earth. When you do your spiritual practices and you connect with whatever you want to call it, consciousness, universe, divine, it's past organic. It's unlimited, it's omnipotent, it's everywhere, not really originating from here. It's originating from everywhere. So it's hard to say exactly that I agree with that, although in many instances you're 100% I agree.
So I agree with that. So religion, I think the good comparison would be corporations. Okay, so there is a very hierarchical system, but also a specific code of conduct. And that's what we get this online training that we have to complete every year and say, yeah, I completed that, something like this. That can happen in a very religion in general or rigid system. But again, to his point, when we look at the culture, a certain culture, maybe a regional area, may be conflicted because they have influences from everywhere. But then there is, depending on the predominance of religion in that particular area or a country, it might create the conflict, and you can see that behavior when that person comes outside. And many times internally it may work fine. I'll just give an example. When I was working for a multinational company, and as a change management, I once went to Italy. And the question there was with the company, the business that we have acquired, do they have a inclusive culture or something of that nature? And jokingly I said, all the heads of the departments or the main central body, they were all Italian men. And I said, you don't have a diversity problem. So in a certain some culture, if you know everyone accepts that this is a way of doing business, then they, even if it's not diverse or whatnot, they may not see that as a problem. But then that person goes into another cultural setup, and then suddenly there are surprises.
I agree with what you said, and I was caught up like in the middle of this clash between the up and the down. And then I had to, anybody here in architecture? Do you agree with me that building anew, it's cheaper than remodeling? In my case, remodeling my spirituality, having been raised by this conservative, when it clashed on me on what I was perceiving as reality and building up my spirituality, there was a lot of guilt there. But opening up, it's the same spiritual, and agreeing with you, Eric, it's the same spiritual wholeness that it's within all religions, whatever the fact that we started learning about them. Because at the beginning, it was religion. It was the castes and the societies were formed by that. But today, thanks to our consciousness, we can choose. And our ability to choose is what keeps us sane, I would say.
Thank you. Any other question anyone has? Just a question.
You guys ask this. You guys are supposed to ask questions, so I got to sit there and think of a question to ask, right? Okay. Okay, so. Okay. So just ask for religion. For me, I believe that there is one God with many names because we all believe that our God is the one way. At some point, many of us believe that, you know, our God is God. When truthfully, we are all just a little lost, doing our best to find our way. Many of us were brought up in culture and our religion. Religion has caused us to either grow or has driven us insane due to the expectations, right? Like you're talking about your mom and dad, due to the expectations of living within our own culture. So I would like to know specifically, maybe just from one or two of you, what life event caused you to search and pull away from some of your own rooted cultures and religion to begin to find your truth of who you are today?
Okay, I'll give my 2 cents. I would say as I started my journey and I became aware of other religions, let's say, I don't think I had a conflict. I just kept on adding to it. And just like I mentioned Joseph Campbell, but there were many others like that. I consider them as my guru. I think their writings kind of helped me. When something I found extremely contradictory, I could go and try to understand why, whether the religious thought or individual thought was so different or so controversial from what I had understood. And I think if you start looking from that particular point of view, the specific geographical region or why that thought might have emerged, then I may not accept that thought, but at least I may understand why they might have come to that realization. So for most part, I would say it was additive. The experiences of other religions were additive to my understanding.
I'll add one bit to it. I traveled in almost 155 countries and I published all these books which are sold in so many countries. One of the things which people have never asked me is, who are you? And maybe, you know, I may not look like their own country people. I've sold books in Africa, Australia, and maybe my message is different. So it all depends how you carry yourself. If you carry yourself in a more spiritual way, despite not knowing the language in Mexico, my biggest Spanish language lessons are Hola, ¿cómo estás? Bien. And with that, I have traveled across Mexico and never felt any need to learn Spanish language. So, and people have respected me, people have given me the honor, and I have taken amazing video shots in Peru without knowing a single word of Spanish or culture, and purely on the basis of spirituality. I think that carries forth much strongly than religion.
I came to believe that everything we know, we learned it either from someone or somewhere, right? So to be grateful to all my teachers, even though I suffered from some of them, coming to realize that I always had the choice. I may not know that I had it, but hindsight 2020, you always have a choice. So integrating my old life journey and teaching corporations how to bring the being to the doing, because sometimes we forget we are human beings and we act as human doers all the time. It's the question of self-discovery, and I've seen that not many people want to go there. They are afraid of what they will look or find in. So back to the instincts, it's like, whatever doesn't walk like me, dress like me, eat like me, cut the onions like me, or fold the clothes like me, then we judge or we fear. But if we follow...